I thought you were going to say how many faces sit on yours. So yeah, I was like, yeah.
That's what I thought he was going to say too.
Yeah. 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 That would be the, so speaking of that,
sorry, continue.
A couple of weeks ago, I got a letter in the mail inviting me to a no strings attached sexual encounter in a hotel room. It's pretty card, looked official. I don't know. I was stupid. I went.
What? Dude, this is nuts.
I'd wear a blindfold. But the woman, I can't even tell you.
Wait, what's going on here? Hold on. Wait, this is really happening? You really did this? In this climate?
PhD, you must have great internet connection. Where are you?
I'm working out of my day job, so they have, I work for a recycling company, and so yeah, they must have really good internet here.
Google Fiber, that's great.
That's awesome.
Recycled fiber.
Yeah.
In the coolest backgrounds, there's, I don't know, I guess the duality of the film is very fitting for...
It's perfect. Yeah, it's perfect. Yeah. It's actually perfectly down the middle too, so it's good. It's good.
Yep. Not by design. Well, good day to you guys. I appreciate your time again. Congratulations on this. This brings some unique perspective to the table, and ultimately, I think it shows you some of the worst, darkest aspects of humanity. What would you say through this plunge of the worst in humanity has taught you about the best in humanity?
I hate to say it, we're very lucky to have significant others that are much better than us, and it's nice. We're like, the moral of the story is that the grass always seems greener on the other side, and be happy with what you've got. It's a bit Buddhist, but really, I mean, we've kind of had that mentality for a while. So although we're making movies about these awful people, talent agents, we're not that. We are the DIY filmmakers that get to make fun of them. So yeah, I don't know. I think the big takeaway for me is the same lessons that we wrote into it a year and a half ago when we were writing the script, 2 years ago when we were writing the script. Is that, it was just like, yeah, don't be happy with what you got.
Yeah. Don't take it for granted, and don't always be looking over the fence, because you might not, seem good at first.
Might not like what you find.
Yeah. So.
If I may ask, how did your significant others respond to this after they saw it?
Well, they were so close to us the whole time in writing it. We're like, I gave my fiance the script, and I was like, yeah, tell me what you think about this, and we kind of walked through everything. And then there were just conversations of like, oh, so we're shooting the hotel scenes tomorrow. And she's like, okay, great. And then we would go to dinner. And then I was like, I don't think she understood me. And then I started like, so we're shooting the hotel scenes tomorrow. And then she was like, oh, let's sit down and talk about it. And then it became us like talking about it. And then it was great. It was like we're all adults. And I mean, she knows it's not a documentary. It's a lot of that. And we're very honest and open and conversational with our partners. So,
right. I think, if anything was better, because it was like, I'm glad you're aware of this and you see that this isn't good. And I hope you don't, go get your own letter and follow through on it.
Uncomfortable showing it to my sisters than my partner. But yeah, that happens. That we made the movie, it's going to come out, people will see it.
Yeah. So does it at all lessen the amount of faces that you carry in your back pocket?
It's a weird one. It's a weird one. Yeah, it does.
Yeah, for sure.
I thought you were gonna say how many faces sit on yours. So
yeah,
I was like,
that's what I thought he was gonna say too.
Yeah. yeah. That would be the. So speaking of that,
Sorry, continue.
One of the things that really stood out to me right away and has stood out in all the films that you've done, Jim, is the language of the film, how the characters talk to each other. Like Jordan, for instance, causes me to do many double takes in the film where, from the way that you deliver lines, you get reeled into the story of it all, and the way Jordan punctuates his sentences with mentions of ulcers or how long he's been sober. Like, it's also a matter of fact that it really elevates the humor.
It's weird non sequiturs as well. So like, he's talking to the guy as the concierge, and he's like, I need to find out who did this. Look, I'm getting married in 6 weeks. I need to know. And like,
Going away. My clients are enjoying spending time.
Yeah, he goes, I'm not going away. My clients enjoy spending time with me. Let me see security camera footage. And it's like these weird things that he's fitting in the thing that are based on all of his other neuroses, but they come out in these funny moments. And PJ and I are like, that's ridiculous. But it's also, he's not a real human. He is this like idiot savant. And so because of that, Yeah, no, we tried to pepper in as many of these like weird Peter Sellers moments as we could.
Yeah, and just like showing how stressed he is, that like the different problems in his life are starting to short circuit and bleed into the others, and he just can't keep all of his lives straight.
He's angry about something else, and then when he's shouting something, we slip in this one piece, this other fight that he's having, and that's really funny.
Yeah. So I was wondering if you could walk me through the science of sentence arrangement and delivery when it comes to humor. Because sure. Obviously you could rearrange how you have it in a different order and even have a completely different effect.
This is my favorite question that we've ever gotten.
Wow. Yeah.
So awesome. We call it word economy. And it's like how many words you put into a sentence to make it work. And what you usually have to do is save the punchline for the very end of the sentence that then changes the entire meaning of what you've heard. Or you can do different inflections on certain syllables throughout the sentence to change the entire meaning of the sentence and the context of the thing. So it really is a sliding scale where we'll be writing a scene and then we were debating whether or not to have PJ, when he's talking, he goes, this could be your wife. This could be my wife. And he says it, and the inflection is on the second my there, this could be my wife. But in one of the takes, he goes, this could be your wife. This could be my wife. And he said it without an inflection. And it was so much funnier to me where it's like, that changed the entire meaning of what he's saying. It becomes this realization for him of like, oh, I'm in trouble. And I was like, that's really funny. And the producers were like, he said it wrong. You've got to change it. And I was like, no, that's funny. It's a joke. He's being real in this moment. It really depends. But we're constantly trying to change the word economy to make the audience think something or feel something. And that's humor.
Yeah. It really is an equation with different variables, and you can quantify humor and plug and play. It's based on math in a lot of ways.
It's chemistry.
It's chemistry and math. Yeah.
And because we are the lead actors, it works really well for us. We're like, we know that we're going to be delivering the lines, so we don't have to tell them to someone else. We know that the joke's going to work in the writer's room 3 months prior.
Because we made each other laugh, and that helps.
Right.
Hoping that most of these people will find funny because it made us laugh.
Yeah.
Where did that awareness come from?
I mean, honestly, just from being adjacent to other comedy filmmakers and like working on set and seeing what was working. And then we're huge fans of Alan Partridge, Steve Coogan's character, where he does the same thing. Like, and in talking to Steve, they used to film stuff on VHS cameras when they were doing the day-to-day, the Christopher Morris radio show, and then became a TV show. And they would film the rehearsals and like the improv, and then they would start laughing, and they would go back through the VHS tape and see where they busted up laughing. Like, cool, that's a sign that was very funny. We should put that in the script. And PJ and I work the same way. We're like, we will record the script as a podcast and act out all the scenes 1,000 times in order to find the best word economy to make the jokes work. And then talking to all of our heroes, like Armando Iannucci, he's like, hey, I'm doing that. We did that in the 80s. There's no difference. So we felt very alone reading screenwriting books and being like, oh, you have to do it this specific way. But it took us doing it out loud 1,000 times before we found a way to write anything good.
Gotcha. So from going from the spoken language, I want to transition to the visual language, which I feel perfectly encapsulates the sort of chaos that is going on within this world, and particularly through Jordan. How did you come up with that visual language? Because there's like I get a certain feeling that it's like, you know, Adam McKay, or there's like a visual essay quality to it as well, especially in the beginning.
Yeah, so PJ and I have seen 1,000 movies. A lot of the visual language that we were basing off of was David Fincher's career, Robert Altman's career, and then Adam McKay's an interesting one. We do have those two sequences where PJ's talking about the Medici family, and then we cut in different stuff, and it feels a bit like a video essay about a certain idea. And then when we're doing the 360 bar stuff, that feels a lot like The Big Short, of like cramming in a bunch of real data into the audience and making it interesting at the same time. All of that is like partially editing mise-en-scene of like what we were able to find in the edit. So although we were leaning more Ruben Osland in like the shooting of the film, there were times where it was like, oh no, we can make this more interesting in these moments because it's making the scenes better, not worse, to be additive. So yeah, there were times in the edit where we found the visual language of the movie. But then for the most part, working with Ken Wales, our cinematographer, we had this like open conversation about how the film should look. And constantly when we're on set, I was a cinematographer for many years before I became a producer and then a director. And so I kind of understand rough language cinematically, what lenses to use exactly, of like, if you use the wide angle camera, but you get close to the wide angle lens, you get close to the person, you still get to feel like you're inside of the space and it becomes a close up, but you don't have to do a two shot. It doesn't have to be an over the shoulder so long as the eye line matches perfectly. And we stole that from the Coen brothers. That's all of their career, basically. So, you know, the scene in like the car dealership in Fargo is all told that way. And so when we're doing the APE talent agency stuff, I was like, I think we can tell this whole story between me and the assistant in this mode. And it became funnier. It became like inside of the tradition of the Coens. And of course it's going to work.
Do you think that you guys would make good psychologists at this point, feeling like you have a good handle on like how people operate and behave?
I think we would be really bad at everything else but making movies. but no, I mean, really, as growing up, we were students of human behavior. PJ was an actor. I was a director. I was constantly watching characters, you know, or kids I went to high school with as if they were characters and understanding how, you know, social dynamics work. And so I think we are decent at it. We understand, you know, the art of the conversation, how things work, how things flow, cadence and all that sort of thing. But no, I think like basing the camera work off of the body language is something specific to us a little bit that we've stolen from Dave, from Uncle Dave, and from many other very talented filmmakers. Ruben Osland does the same thing. But I just find that to be connective tissue between the audience and the filmmaker. And we're lucky that we're the actors in the film, so that when I'm walking between scenes in the hotel and then the APE meeting, and you see me look over my shoulder and I go like this, and then we cut into the APE room and I go, hey, how's it going? And I sit down. We don't have to have establishing shots of the location. We immediately thrust the audience between the scenes based on the biology of my head turn. And it's like, that's something that we didn't discover until Wolf of Snow Hollow, where I was like, oh yeah, you can do this because it's the same actor and that cut is a match. It's interesting.
Yeah, I don't know if we could be good psychologists. We can certainly highlight problems that people have and maybe give a take on them and show why that can be funny or poignant or sad. I don't know if we could technically fix it.
We couldn't give a prescription.
Yeah, I don't think we could technically fix it.
Couldn't write any prescriptions.
We could we could highlight it and showcase it in the narrative, but that might be tough to give them actual advice on how to do about it, because that's why we're posing the questions in these movies, because we don't know. And if anyone knows, let us know. Yeah. We'd like to find out.
Yeah.
Yeah. So through your collaboration on this, how did you challenge each other's thinking through all this? Because there's a lot of conversations happening and a lot of happenings within the past couple of years. And so I feel like you take a lot of different things and you got to be able to balance all those things and also make a compelling narrative out of it.
I think because we have such high ambitions about making our movies, we kind of bully each other that like, it's got to be dope and it's not working. And it's like, it's got to work. We have to make this thing work. And so like, because we're such scientists in our minds, we're not artists. It's like, this is an equation. This can work. We got to make it great. And then we'll just pound the keyboards until it's working, or we'll get it up and act it out on its feet 1,000 times until we find the right thing that it's actually making us laugh. There's a quote, it's not true about women and heart attacks, but male heart attacks, it is. If you have to ask yourself if you're having a heart attack, you're not having a heart attack, is what they say. And we feel that of like, if you're reading a script and you're not being moved by it, it's like, this is the right thing, this is gonna work. And so we have to like bully each other into making sure that it's actually getting a reaction out of someone.
I mean, if there's scenes that are pointless or just not good enough set up and payoff, or just lines that just aren't funny, just useless dialogue, forcing each other to be honest about it and say, do we either lose it or we change it?
This is superfluous.
Or, yeah.
Yeah, there's no point in having this in the movie. We need to change this. Yeah.
And I think Beta, what I like a lot about Beta is that, it's just
non-stop.
It's non-stop, and every scene really matters to get us to the next stage of his journey. And
we read all of the scripts that were supposed to be very good when we were coming up in Hollywood. And then I just found them boring or lame or tame or just like not, like there was no word economy. Like it seems as though they weren't putting in the effort to make the thing perfect before it went out the door. And so we want to do that. Like we realize that it's not hard for us. It's not expensive for us. We're just going to be talking to each other over the phone 1,000 times and making the thing. And so we wanted to be that change. And it comes to us easily sometimes.
Sometimes.
So with this film and also Snow Hollow kind of dealing with interactions with stress, obviously I can only imagine that you're feeling your stress of a new kind from putting this film out that uses certain quotes from people that are 100% true. And then you're putting this film out there, and I can only imagine what you must be feeling, especially when more and more eyes see it. So do you have to like plug into the lessons that you explore in here a little bit through all that?
I mean, so Dave Chappelle has a good bit where he's talking about people saying that he's offensive, or he said some joke that he shouldn't say. He says, I never feel bad about what I say up here on stage. And I made a point of that for my whole life. Everybody claps. It's like, if I'm on stage, I'm doing stand up, I never feel bad about what I say. I leave it on the stage. I did the thing. I said the thing, whatever. Purposely don't feel any shame for what I do in my art form. And I feel the same way. PJ and I were very nervous before making the film. And then once you're doing it and you're in the trenches of actually doing the thing and saying the lines out loud that you know you're gonna get in trouble for, you become bulletproof. And so we've kind of stopped caring about that. It's like, well, we were tame. We pulled punches. We should have gone harder, you know? I don't know. I'm not worried in the slightest.
I think it could have been a lot worse. And I think if anything, I think it was the right thing to do for the narrative,
it's like
for the
comedy
story. I mean, it's a joke. It's funny. I don't know. I mean, yeah.
I don't know. And I think like really anybody who's been in Hollywood, who like works an assistant, who like came to our backyard and watched the movie, is horrified, but is also like, thank you for making this thing. And it's like, yeah, it was great. It like caused PTSD in my mind, but it's a comedy and I was laughing the whole time. So yeah, I don't know. I think the movie will be celebrated, and I think it's long overdue. The power dynamics haven't shifted.
Yeah, yeah. And as a last question, you guys have a lot of different responsibilities going into this. Do you guys feel that you are actors who happen to be really good filmmakers, or good filmmakers who also happen to be actors?
I don't know. I mean, PJ's the actor. PJ's the actual trained actor. I have no training, so I feel very inadequate by comparison. I don't know. I think like filmmaking is the word for me, of like doing all of them at once, I think is what I'm good at. Like,
I like to say storytellers that just come like, you know, with technical pluses that we're able to pull off, and you know, and storytelling, I would like to say be good at. And the acting is part of that, is telling the story.
Yeah.
The writing, acting, and the technical filmmaking that we're able to bring together as an entity, I think, is just, in general, good storytelling, hopefully.
Yeah. The joke is that PJ doesn't know anything about cameras, and I don't know anything about acting.
together, hopefully, we can tell a good story and make a damn good movie. That would be...
And hopefully nobody notices our shortcomings.
Yeah, exactly.
But, yeah. Between the two of us, yeah.
Right.
I think maybe now is a good time we all take a break and reassess what it is we're doing here.